This is James Hype, and this is How I DJ.
I remember seeing DJs in music videos, wanting to do what they did because I thought that they made the music and I didn't understand what DJing really was. When I first got decks, I didn't really know of any DJs. I knew of a lot of like record producers and I was like, oh, that's what they do. They have decks. So I was quite naive as to what a DJ actually did. So yeah, I just really liked the idea of taking a record from here and making it into something else. So I maybe thought that it was more of a remix tool than a tool to play music to people. And that was something that I discovered later in my journey. Okay, so with the hot cues in this mix, we started off with a hot cue assigned to a loop on this. I'm triggering it with the hot cue right on the beat. The hot cue loop assigned again on deck two. Triggering it with the hot cue. On the third deck, I actually use a hot cue to jump out of a loop. So I'm in the mix like this. I've then got a loop going. Just gonna keep on going around. When the time is right, I'm gonna go. So the hot cue in that instance is being used to start the track from a different point, but it's also being used to break out of the loop because I didn't have to exit the loop at all. On deck four, I'm using the hot cue to trigger the vocal. So I think the importance of hot cues here is it allows me to jump around the track while the track's still playing. That's the most important thing. Like, if I didn't have the hot cues and I was trying to do this on deck three, then I'd be like, and then I'd have to kind of pull the fader down and go, and then skip to the bit I want. But because of the hot cue, we can leave the fader up and do it. And because of the quantize being turned on as well, we're not gonna go out of time with the other tracks in the mix. Now, on this a cappella as well, in this example, I didn't really use it, but we've got. So I've assigned three different important parts of the a cappella to the hot cue. So we could actually use it to kind of play through the track. So you could be like. So they allow me flexibility to turn the track from its original structure into a different structure without having to stop it and rewind it or anything like that. The important thing here is to make sure that your hot cues are in the position that you think you're going to need them in while you're in record box. So we used to have four hot cues on a CDJ 2000, and then they put eight hot cues, but they were kind of hidden away. Obviously now there's eight. Now I've been adding more hot cues to my tracks for sure. Like I've got certain tracks where I've got all eight hot cues. It tends to be something that I'll do with acapellas more so, because if I maybe chop a phrase up word for word, then I can almost play it like drums on the hot cues. Like I don't have the best tracks here to demo it, but. So yeah, you can kind of start making it into a percussive thing. The first gig I ever did in a nightclub, was the first day I ever used Pioneer DJ equipment. I rented a room in this music school place where I knew they had CDJs. And I used CDJs for the first time that day. I booked like a 2-hour slot to practice on these CDJs. Never used them before. I didn't know what any of the buttons did. YouTube tutorials might have existed, but this wasn't a time when they were normal. Like, right now, you'd be like, oh, how does this work? Let me Google it, let me YouTube it, right? Back then, no. I just remember like playing with these decks and I was like, they feel amazing. It's really easy to mix on them. I don't know how Pioneer managed that, but they've always made it easier than other CDJs to mix on. But I didn't even understand like the purpose of the cue button and things like that. So I was winging it so badly. And my first paid, well, it was a paid trial in a nightclub. It was 5 hours. Right, and prior to that, I think I'd been paid before, but I used to do like 2 hours in a bar. No one came to this bar. And yeah, I went along to this gig with about 40 tracks. And somehow I knew that a DJ wasn't allowed to repeat songs. And I was absolutely terrified because it got to like the fourth hour and I was like, I've run out of music. I actually ran out of music on my first gig, yeah. Okay, so one of the techniques that I use during this mix is looping. So on the first deck, I've got an automatic loop that I've set up in Rekordbox. And assigned to a hot cue. So we've got a 16-beat loop on this part of the instrumental. And that's gonna keep on going around. I've set that up in Rekordbox and assigned it to the hot cue. The hot cue's turned orange, which means there's a loop on there. And that'll keep on looping until I stop it. On the second deck, we've got I Can't Stop a cappella, which starts off with a hot cue loop again, which is a 16-beat loop again. So I've set that up in Rekordbox, 16-beat loop, assigned it to hot cue A. As you can see, that goes round and round by itself. Now, at one point in the mix, I change where the loop is. So it lands on the word stop over and over. I'm then going to halve that loop with this half button here. Gets half. And then we can change the length of it with the in and out points. So I'm going to start with the out point, and I can shorten where the loop ends. I can then do the same with the in, and it ends up sounding like a tone. Once I've got that tone, I can stop and start it with the play button and the vinyl adjust. Looping on deck three. So the track's starting like this. Very shortly after I've started it, I'm triggering an 8-beat loop with the built-in button on the CDJ 3000 for the loop. I'm then going to exit the loop with the hot loop. And there is no looping on deck four for this one. So I find that I end up using looping so much when I'm DJing, especially when you bring more than two decks into the mix. Like, I can have four decks playing in the mix, and if all four of them are in a loop, then I know that I've got like total control to take it wherever I want. Say this one is in a breakdown, this one's in a breakdown, this one's a vocal, this one's going to build up into the drop. It allows me to be in control of where the tune goes. So I had a phase in my career where I started playing open format, which to anyone who doesn't know what that means all genres, just crowd reaction, playing the bangers, and I became really good at that. I started getting loads of money from that and stuff, and I was like, oh, this is probably not where I want to be, because it's really fun for now, but I don't really see where this is going. So I was like, okay, well, I'm making house music, so I need to play house music. So I need to kind of take that step away from this open format thing that I'm really good at, but I have to kind of take a step backwards to get to where I want to be. So I think I changed my DJ style a lot while I was doing the open format thing. I then took that back to the house music thing. And then I was maybe looking at the house music from a different perspective to somebody who's only ever played house music. So when I was the open format DJ, I started using Serato with a laptop and CDJ control. So as soon as I decided I wanted to be a house DJ and not an open format DJ, I was like, the laptop has to go. I looked at festivals, I looked at like all the big dance music artists. Nobody's there using Serato and a laptop. There are a few exceptions, but I was like, I need to tell people that I'm a real house DJ. So the laptop's got to go. So I bought two CDJ 2000 Nexus 1s
I started doing live streams. This is literally 2016. Just DJing for an hour, just learning how to use the decks.
Yo, what's up? We are Periscope, Facebook, it's live, let's go. I'm new to the CD here, so don't judge me, please.
Shortly after that, I bought a third deck. I was frustrated that I couldn't DJ as fast as I used to be able to on Serato. So I got the third deck thinking, oh, well, that'll make me a bit faster. Like I can drop an acapella over tunes and stuff. Got really good at three decks. And then Pioneer DJ asked me to do DJ Soundtrack. And I was like, this is amazing, massive opportunity. Because I've been making videos on Facebook and stuff and people have been paying attention. So I think Pioneer DJ lent me another deck me to practice on, and I just put together like a 1 hour routine on four decks, and it's so hard to use four decks when you haven't used four decks before. But yeah, from that point onwards, that's been me, four deck guy.
Okay, so if we look at the mixer section here, this might look random, but I have made very specific choices about the EQ settings and the filters and stuff. So when I'm trying to do a four deck transition, I'm very conscious that it can get very messy very quickly because four songs aren't meant to be played together. I've made conscious decisions, A, in what tracks I'm going to play, but then B, in how they're EQ'd and they're put together. So obviously this acapella starts us off. There's no low end in it at all, so you don't have to worry about that like clashing in the low end. So then this plays. And then I start going like this on this track. I've deliberately used the low pass filter on this to take out the top end, because the top end's going to be. And it's going to be bright and it's going to sound louder than this because this has hi-hats in it. Hi-hats are going to sit frequency-wise on top of the vocal. So if we do this, then it can kind of sound like it's coming from the background. So. And then as I open up the filter, it's going to sound like it's getting closer to you. I've also taken some of the bass out because if we had the bass in, there's quite a lot of like messiness in the low end. So if I can eliminate that. The other thing I can do with the bass is I can make it feel like it's getting further away and closer to you. So that's one thing that I do is as it's building up, I'll be bringing the bass up and the filter up. This deck, I've used the EQs quite strongly, literally just to boost the frequencies because it seemed quite quiet when it was playing over everything. This is something when you're playing for four decks, like things don't always like cut through. So I've boosted the EQs because this seemed quite quiet. I don't like playing with the gains when I play. I like leaving the gains at zero. So I tend to just boost here. May or may not be the correct thing to do. That's how I play. On this one, I've taken out a little bit of the bass because, again, it doesn't have any bass in it and I don't want it to have any bass in it. I want all the bass to come from this track. So that then when this one drops, like you can feel the bass is building here. And then when it drops, like you get the full force of the bass. The other thing I've been using in this is the echo. So I start the echo out on deck two. It's on a 3/4 beat echo, which is 10. It's my go-to, really. It just sounds nice in the mix. It just adds a bit of space. So again, I'm trying to make things feel like they're a bit further away, and then they're going to get a lot closer to you when they're on the drop. So we start with the echo here. It just makes it feel a bit washed out and spacious. And then as soon as I start playing on this deck, I switch the echo over to deck four so that this then feels like that. Because if you listen to this without the echo, it's a very dry acapella. As we're coming up to the drop, I'll tend to take the bass out of anything with bass in it. So as we're coming up to drop on Joker, I'll be using the filter on No Good. Just to make sure that No Good is coming out of the way a little bit to make space for Joker on the drop. There's a lot of record box prep required. And the record box prep allows me to do stuff on the fly because if my tracks are categorized correctly, if my acapellas are labeled correctly, if the hot cues are in the right place, then I don't have to listen in my headphones to know, oh, say, that hot cue one's going to be on the first word, or that loop there is going to be on that word. So because they're well prepared, I can load them on the fly, and because they're marked in key and things like that, it allows me to do stuff on the fly. When it's a show where I expect a more commercial audience,
I'll kind of take a selection of my most well-known transitions and kind of put them together with a couple of new bits. Whereas if it's a more underground show, then I'm going to be looking for new stuff. I'm going to be looking for heavier stuff. I'd probably actually spend longer putting a set together for a more underground show than I would for a more commercial show. Because with a more commercial show, not so much is going to change.
So I use in-ear headphones or in-ear monitors when I'm DJing, which is not like the most normal thing, I'm aware. Now, the way that works is, obviously, I've got these both in my head. They isolate the noise all around me. I can still feel the bass from the speakers, but I can't really hear the speakers too loud. It's really good because it allows me to control the volume of what's going into my ears. So if I'm in a really like echoey club, in-ears will sort me out. If I'm in a really quiet room, like recording a DJ video in my apartment late at night, I can still DJ loud in my ears. If I'm on a big stage and there's a lot of feedback, a lot of delay, then the in-ears have got me. So also they help me like protect my ears. It's kind of like earplugs and headphones in one. So I really like them. I use them in mono split mode, which means I'll hear the master in my right ear and I'll hear the PFL, which is whichever one of these is highlighted in my left ear. That takes quite a lot of getting your head around because you're literally like, it's like you're in the mix in the middle of your brain. It allows me to very quickly identify which track is out of sync just by kind of hitting these cues. And you'll probably watch while I'm DJing, I'll do a lot of, because I'm in my head, I'm constantly monitoring what tracks are going on. So yeah, the biggest challenge is actually just getting your head around what's playing where. It's not difficult to keep two songs in time when you've got quantized music on expensive CD players. That's not difficult. So you can do four of them, you could do eight of them, but you need to remember which one's where, so that if number three starts going out, you need to know from listening, oh, it's number three that's out. That's the part that's really hard. What's it gonna be?